Good morning, and welcome to our final spotlight session. You are the brave souls that have showed up after the reception and the sake last night. So little do you know, but you get brownie points today. You get extra points for being here. So thank you for coming. Thank you for coming to this, the final spotlight session of our World Congress. I am Annie Heiderscheid, and I am pleased to be moderating this session. And I would like to thank the Japanese Music Therapy Association for being such wonderful and amazing hosts, and our spotlight speakers today who have so freely given their time and sharing their expertise with us today. So please be sure to turn off your phones, your devices, so that we can have a wonderfully on-task session. And before I introduce our speakers, I want to just bring our thoughts to culture a bit. So I think we have been getting, not only experiencing, but hearing about and having it infused in our time here together, not only music, but music and culture. So it is thought that music creates and shapes culture, and that culture creates and shapes music. So this demonstrates a rather circular relationship for us. So today we will explore the role of music in the context of culture and how this has an impact on music therapy. So we get to explore music from cultures around the world. And I think it's always just interesting as we look at not only the music, but instruments from other cultures. The sounds, the timbres that that gives us from other cultures. And the diversity that that brings us from around the world. So our speakers today will bring us this focus on music in the cultural context, and how music varies from culture to culture, the implications that this has on selecting music for use in our therapeutic process, as well as this focus on diverse cultures from Japan, South Africa, Norway, and the United States. So I want to thank our spotlight speakers for sharing their expertise and wisdom on this topic, and we'll ask that you hold your questions till the end so that we can hear from our speakers. So, this is who you are, have the great pleasure of hearing today. Our first speaker is Riko Ikuno. She is a faculty of core research at Oshimizu University and a lecturer and supervisor at Tokai University, the chairperson at Nobano Learning Nest for Music and Human Development. She studied music and music therapy in the US, has worked as a clinician and educator in Japan in the field for 20 years, and she's translated several books into Japanese, several music therapy texts into Japanese. Our next speaker is Sunel Fauchier. She graduated with her master's degree in music therapy from the University of Pretoria in South Africa. And in 2003, she co-founded the nonprofit organization Music Works, and she currently serves as its executive director. She's committed to developing contextually sensitive music therapy practices and making these accessible to children growing up in marginalized communities. Our third spotlight speaker is Dr. Laura Beer. Dr. Beer is the chair of Art, Music, and Creative Arts Therapies and the Music Therapy Program at Merrillhurst University. She's an experienced clinician, researcher, and educator. She's authored numerous journal articles, a monograph, and is a published songwriter. She is currently engaged in clinical work in a NICU setting, and her research interests include multicultural issues in music therapy and arts-based research. Our fourth spotlight speaker is Dr. Bruno Stiga. Dr. Stiga is the professor of music therapy at the University of Bergen. He's the head of research at the Grieg Academy of Music Therapy Research Center at the University of Bergen and the Uni Research. And his interests in research include culture, community, practice, and theory. He is the co-editor of Voices, a world forum for music therapy, and he's the coordinator of Polyphon Knowledge Cluster for Music Therapy. So please join me in welcoming our spotlight speakers. And we will begin with Dr. Rika Ikuno.
Good morning, everyone. Ohayou gozaimasu. I'm so honored to be here, and all my thanks to everyone here and everybody related to this Congress. The other day, an American musicologist asked me, how do Japanese music therapists use Japanese traditional music? And I stumbled. My inner monologue was this, well, I'm Japanese, but actually, as a pianist, I grew up with Do, Re, Mi. And to begin with, in our daily lives, Japanese traditional music does not play such a significant role. Well, but wait, I sometimes use Japanese drums in my session, and I replicate the sound of the shamisen, Japanese banjo, with a synthesizer. Japanese pop songs I play on the piano are often composed on the pentatonic scale. Yeah, we could say that we are actually using Japanese music, but not in a pure way that foreigners might expect. Having grown up in Japan, studied the professional basics of music therapy in the United States, and having practiced in Japan for 20 years whilst communicating with international music therapists, one of the strong impressions I have about Japanese people in general when I'm asked this kind of question is our omnivorous attitude to music. By omnivorous, I mean that we not only have abundant music resources to choose from to enjoy, but we also seem to actively shift, adjust to, or even mix different musical styles very smoothly. The tendency seems to have been partly developed due to the social phenomena and drastic changes in the musical environment we have experienced in the last 200 years. First, let us roughly review this story. According to Dr. Makino, a music therapist and psychiatrist who studied traditional Japanese music and ethnomusicology at Tokyo University of the Arts, music up to the Edo era had features such as intimacy with sound nature, emphasis on expression through changes of timbre, including noises, sensing other players' movement, postures, breathing, sounds, and their relationship to avoid complete synchronicity within ensemble. Intentional use of delicate inconsistency in beat and pitch, and so on. Also, it often involved spontaneous movement and improvisatory lyrics. To summarize, traditional Japanese musicking seemed to have subtler, more embodied, and relational improvisational aspects compared to Western classical style music. But the Meiji government suddenly urged the school system to adopt the Western-style education in order to catch up with these internationally powerful countries. School music was reformed as ongaku throughout the nation based on the structure of the European classics. Tackling totally different music from the Edo era was such a drastic change. But more importantly, as Professor Wakao says, ongaku was imprinted in Japanese mind as something to be performed collectively, correctly, as a good citizen, and a master's leadership. Such an attitude to music strongly connected with the militarism Japan had gone through in the early Showa era. After the defeat in World War II, the new democracy and economic growth led all kinds of music to suddenly flow into Japan. The socio-musical trends since then, such as pop and jazz music brought by the American occupational forces, prevalence of piano and violin early education in 1960s to 70s, as school choirs and brass bands' active involvement in competition, Sony's invention of Walkman, increasing popularity of karaoke and electric keyboard, contributed to make Japan one of the biggest musical markets in the world. Based on this development, choices of music became completely up to the individual, and experiencing such a drastic change in just 200 years seems to be one factor in becoming highly omnivorous for music. I am a Japanese myself, but when I reflect on what I experienced in foreign cultures, I have been secretly amazed with Japanese omnivorous attitude. For example, how casually Japanese people introduce and imitate different styles of music from their own to achieve semi-professional mastery as if they were grew up with it. Sometimes to combine the different elements of existing styles to create a new style as they wish, or to shift from one style to the other so smoothly. In the program of TV shows and concerts, musical lessons or karaoke, and in music therapy sessions, Japanese people naturally and skillfully enjoy tremendous variety in musical taste. In fact, this attitude is also seen in Japanese people's daily action, such as eating and religious ceremonies. Most of Japanese housewives would naturally make Japanese style, Chinese style, Korean style, Indian style, Italian style, American style, or some French style dishes daily for their families. It is not necessarily because Japanese housewives are all superwomen, but simply because all of these cuisines have become our regular foods. There are a lot of cooking ingredients and kits for these international foods sold in most regular supermarkets. Actually, in my house, the person who is taking the lead for the joy of multicultural cooking is not myself as a housewife, but my dear husband. Our attitude to religious custom is also omnivorous. It is not surprising for us to spend the winter like this. You can see Christianity, Buddhism, Shintoism, and folk ritual all mixed up in our daily lives. Is it too confusing to follow such a complicated ritual schedule? No problem, since the convenience store in your neighborhood will tell you what to do and what to buy now, one after another. In fact, to get into the reason for living in modern Japanese society, this is a kind of cultural obligation or the default. You are expected to follow them one after another, regardless of your own principle or opinion. Why are Japanese people so enthusiastic about these omnivorous cultural activities? Through my personal and professional experiences, I have a presumption that the skillfulness in which they imitate and perform certain styles and the acrobatic smoothness with which they switch between these different styles suggest the effort to put self-assertiveness aside and a wish to be a part of the environment. Whilst making this effort, their keen and constant consciousness is not actually on the content of the style, but on the unspoken and ultimate goal behind the actions, co-presence. Being together. Co-presence is doubtlessly one of the most important subjects for human beings, and we can learn about it from diverse wisdoms in diverse cultures. Here, I would like to share my view on my Japanese sense of co-presence, one which is slightly different from my experiences in Western cultures. In the Western countries, when I participate in a classroom or sit at the dinner table, I sense the cultural demand that each person has to speak up from a very early stage to represent his or her identity. By throwing statements back and forth and clarifying each standpoint, the common field is gradually built. It is such a democratic and reasonable way of co-presence. On the other hand, if you cannot participate in this dynamic, you are regarded not to be present. When I was a foreign student in America, not fluent in English, I often felt as if I were an invisible person and used to lament, America is a country of freedom, but there's no freedom not to talk. In short, in Western culture, I and you build the common field rationally by piling up bricks one by one through verbal communication. Each person is allowed to keep their own position firm at the edge of the field and can go back anytime when they need to. Participating in common field as the individual seems to be a fundamental basis of co-presence in the Western culture. By contrast, it is we that emerges first in any form of Japanese community. Coherent existence of we is critical for the stability of the space and for any significant events to be developed or even to be touched upon. Therefore, each person's attitude to collaboration and voluntary involvement is a fundamental basis of co-presence in Japanese culture. So what we do first in the classroom or at the dinner table is not to make statements to show our identities, but rather to find a spot to fit in the common space. In the university classroom, the students decide where to sit and when to ask questions, carefully sensing what is quietly going on among the members more than their own needs. At the parties, not only the host but all the participants constantly serve foods and drinks to each other. In this way, we start our co-presence directly from collaboration, not so much from communication. The important thing here is that you have to work this out not only by verbal but also by non-verbal actions, ways of moving and timing. Japanese people learn from childhood to collaborate for the dynamism of we, using all five senses, including kehai, the Japanese concept of indication of presence of sign or sign from the surroundings. I think this peculiar Japanese way of co-presence could be used as a unique music therapy technique. For example, the aspect of Japanese music in the Edo era we have been seeing before could open up many possibilities for music making within music therapy sessions. In my doctoral dissertation, I named this kind of co-presence appearing in musical relationship as to become a habitant or dwell in the musical field. What habitant or dwelling symbolize is a mental attitude of moving out from your own territory, cutting off the route to retreat, and to become a part of the common space. In my clinical experiences in Japan, significant therapeutic changes often happen at the moment both therapist and client have become equal habitants in the musical common field. And it is an important role of the therapist to initiate dwelling in the musical field by his or her way of musicking. It is very difficult to share this kind of clinical experience in a big hall like this, but let me just play one excerpt from my own therapy session with a child with profound developmental delay. This girl had no verbal abilities nor any forms of communicational exchanges in her daily actions. The higher notes on the piano and the softer singing voice is the child's. Thank you. Scottish community music specialist Jane Bentry categorizes the use of music in community setting as just music, music for, and music with. It is a very useful taxonomy to explain the role of music in the certain communities. But when I think of Japanese style of co-presence, I would also like to add music to dwell together. I think this kind of sense already broadly prevails in Japanese music therapy practices. However, in the socio-cultural actions of Japanese people, there are many intangible elements which emerge and disappear that cannot be explained well in the linguistic and deductive academic style that are conventional in the Western traditions. As previously mentioned, another feature of the Japanese mentality is to be nonverbal. We tend not to speak out about the most essential, relying on sensing in the co-presence to keep balance in an ever-changing environment. As a representative of Japanese people, I apologize for this complexity. But I beg non-Japanese people to attempt to understand this cognitive and behavioral habit of ours as full of contradiction as it is. On the other hand, for Japanese music therapists who have learned so much from the Western theories, it is time to somehow face and investigate the originality of our music and our community. It is significantly important to investigate and reconsider the relational dynamics between client and therapist within the Japanese cultural context. Who is a music therapist and what is music therapy? By co-presenting as we in clinical settings, in what direction are we heading for? To do so, shall we put the theories aside for a moment and make a practice turn, as Dr. Stiege advocates, and start creating our own music therapy derived from our own realities? Thank you.
There they are. Thank you, Dr. Okuno. And now we will hear from Ms. Sunel Fauchier.
Good morning. And thank you to the organizing committee for this opportunity. South Africa is a country at the southern tip of Africa. It has a population of around 55.6 million people, and it consists of a diverse range of cultural groupings. And this is evident in the 11 official languages of the country, 10 of which are indigenous, and the 11th English was brought to us by British colonizers in the 19th century, and it's the second language of most people in the country. Over the past 15 years, I've been working as a music therapist in Cape Town, South Africa, and many centuries ago, the indigenous people of the Cape, the Khoisan, named this place at the southern tip of Africa, Urikwahu, meaning mountain in the sea. And today, Cape Town is home to close to 4 million people, consisting of four main cultural groupings: Xhosa, Afrikaner, English, and so-called colored people. And this is a term that does not have the same derogatory denotation as it has in other parts of the world, but it's a term that was devised by the apartheid government to describe the descendants of the indigenous Khoisan and Malay slaves. And it's still used today to describe a specific cultural grouping. And in South Africa, we cannot talk about culture without also considering race. And this is the unfortunate legacy that was left to us by the apartheid government that forcefully divided people along racial lines. So during the forced removals under the Apartheid Government's Group Areas Act, black and colored people were moved to townships and informal settlements outside of city centers. And although we now do have a democratic government, to a great extent, these racial divisions created not only by apartheid, but by 400 years of colonialism, still exist within the geographical, the social, and the economic structures of our society. And so it's in these townships and informal settlements outside of Cape Town, inhabited predominantly by Xhosa and colored people, that I've spent my professional life working as a music therapist for the nonprofit organization Music Works. Music Works' vision is to generate hope and possibility for children through shared engagements in music, and specifically to children growing up in these marginalized communities outside of Cape Town. So, I am a South African, but I also belong to the cultural grouping of Afrikaners. So, my ancestors derive from the Dutch settlers that colonized South Africa 400 years ago. And if you were to Google Afrikaner music, you would probably come across something that sounds like this. However, this is ancestrally received cultural music, and I'm not really comfortable with, and in fact, it makes me cringe. As for me, it is a stark reminder of the apartheid era and the role my ancestors played in imposing laws that segregated white from black. So what you see on the screen now is the old South African flag, and this today is a cultural symbol that signifies oppression and the social and economic injustices of apartheid. So what music then does represent my cultural identity? In December 2013, the father of the democratic South Africa, Nelson Mandela, passed away. And to South Africans, and I'm sure to the rest of the world as well, Nelson Mandela was a symbol of justice, equality, and dignity for all people. And as the first president of our democratic nation, he represented the ideals of reconciliation and nation building of a new non-racial South African society. And 3 days after his death, my family and I attended a concert at the Cape Town Stadium that was held in honor of Nelson Mandela. Now, South African enjoys singing. In fact, we sing a lot. And the concert was attended by more than 50,000 people, other South Africans, representing the cultural and racial diversity of our nation. And we all sang along to the many songs that not only honored Nelson Mandela, but in that moment allowed us to reorganize ourselves to represent his dream of a unified nation. And so if you ask me what music represents my cultural identity, then these are the songs that I would sing to you. This is by the group Freshly Ground. Please go and Google it. It's lovely music. So why am I telling you this story? As a nonprofit organization working within the community development sector, Music Works offers volunteer positions to music therapy students who come mostly from the global north. Before the students arrive, I often get asked this question via email. What songs do I need to bring? And this is a very reasonable question to ask. I always find myself struggling to answer this question. I can't help imagining the student Googling African music and thinking that that would give them answers as to the music that they need to bring. Because you see, the students might be placed in a children's home, and there will be children from a range of different cultural groupings, some Xhosa, some colored, some Afrikaans. And although it's useful to familiarize yourself with the cultural musical genre of the client of a culture different to your own, I cannot possibly expect the students to get a grip on the diverse range of cultural music that they'll come across in their work in South Africa. But more importantly, I think my struggle in answering this question has more to do with what is possibly hidden behind it, this idea of bringing music, even if this refers to the students' reinterpretation of the local cultural music. It reminds very much of the intervention as solution approach to health and well-being, as often practiced by the international development sector. Pavlisevic and Impey critically reflects on this notion, and they propose in contrast, a stance of deep listening that encompasses cultural, social, and therapeutic listening. By bringing music, we're extracting this cultural, social, and you could see from my example, perhaps even politically loaded artifact from its context, and we're bringing it, and I might even suggest imposing our interpretation of it back to the client. In contrast, through deep listening, we place the music that the client brings firmly within its cultural and social context. And the client's music, with all that it represents and means for health and well-being, is what then guides the therapeutic process. As a music therapist with training based on the Nordhoff Robbins approach, I see the world through a Western frame. But working within the South African context, I need to be really careful not to project this as the dominant frame onto the local context. I need to be really listening, deeply listening, to the local indigenous knowledge systems and what this means with regards to health and well-being. So when I walk into a music therapy room with children growing up in marginalized communities in a culture different from my own, I'm not only entering the space as a music therapist, but I'm also entering it as a white person, an Afrikaner, a woman, a professional, a person from the middle class. And I'm moving into communities where these cultural and social identities are often viewed with some suspicion. To some, I might represent an oppressive past, someone quite foreign, different, exotic, perhaps wealthy with access to resources. And I might be viewed with suspicion because of my gender. And it's crucial that I'm aware of all these identities and what they could represent to the clients and how their perspective on me could impact the therapeutic relationship. And then there's the other side to this. I need to be mindful of the power dynamics that might hinder me from recognizing the resilience and the resources that the people I work with already have. I found one specific musical game or activity very useful to create a space where the group members' differences and their similarities could safely be brought to the surface. In this Step Into the Circle game, the group members are seated, as you can see there on the screen. They're seated in a circle around a drum, and I'll start the game by saying, "Step into the circle and play on the drum if you like soccer. Football, if you're wearing pink, or if you like to eat chicken." And the group members will then get up and beat the drum if the questions resonate with them. And I then perhaps ask questions on a more personal level. So step into the circle if you're sometimes bullied, if you're feeling angry, if you have scary dreams. The next step in this game is to then open the floor to the group members to ask the questions. And time again, the question inevitably turns to race and culture. So the children might ask, "Step into the circle and play on the drum if you speak Xhosa or Afrikaans, if you're black or white, if you live in Sea Point, a more affluent area in Cape Town, or if you live in Khayelitsha, a township." And over the years, I've learned that this musical game can be a highly effective tool to bring to the surface the differences of the people in the room, and at the same time, highlight that which we have in common. So children might find solace and courage when they see their peers stepping forward about bullying. And I found that this game really gives the children permission or an access point in bringing to the surface the so-called elephant in the room, the curiosities or suspicions they might have about my and about each other's race, culture, and social differences. And so once we name this elephant in the room, it's visible for all to see. We're not stepping around it or avoiding it, but once we've spoken it and played with it within the safe structure of this musical game, we can move through it or work with it. In my practice, I've often come across this phenomenon that I will refer to as the denial of culture. Often in institutionalized settings where Western ways of doing and thinking prevail, like, for example, hospitals, patients seem to shed their culture. Within this medical setting, culture seems to be viewed as something that does not belong here, that's not relevant, in some cases perhaps even primitive or rural, and that it has no place here. A few years ago, Music Works was asked to contribute to an arts and health project at a local hospital treating patients with multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis. And the patients would remain in the hospital for between 3 and 6 months, and sometimes even longer. And many of the adult patients coming here were from rural areas. Many were from cultural groups for whom music is an integral part of daily life. It's a form of spiritual expression. It's a part of traditional healing practices, and it contributes towards their health and well-being. But in this hospital setting, there seemed to be no place for this. So in this Music Works program at the hospital, music therapists collaborated with community musicians, and they organized open groups on the wards that took the form of sing-alongs. So the facilitators supported patients in bringing their traditional songs and dances into the space, and it really transformed the space. In that moment, the patients could claim a part of the space as theirs, and they had some sense of control of it. It provided opportunities for cross-cultural sharing, and each patient would be supported in his singing and dancing by the other patients on the ward. So here, in this moment, the patients were tapping into their own cultural musical traditions with the benefits that it has for contributing towards health and well-being from the perspective of their own cultural belief systems. So when thinking about working with clients from a culture different to our own, we could use this diagram to illustrate this. But there is a risk here. Culture, as a frame, is often used to highlight what is different about us, and it could actually polarize. So by exclusively focusing on a cross-cultural frame, by centralizing these gaps between us, are we at risk of making invisible that which we have in common, our shared humanity? When we use this diagram to illustrate our work, then what becomes centralized is our shared humanity. So when we are being mindful of the complexity of culture, when we're employing deep listening, considering the broader cultural and social context, then we are able to create spaces where deep connection and shared humanity can flourish. And all of us as music therapists know this space, this central space in the graph. We've experienced this with our clients. On surface level, disability or illness or pain or trauma might seem to create a gap between a client and those around him, but music allows us to step into this space of shared humanity in a very direct and immediate way. I will end with a short clip from a concert that was part of a Music Works project, where young people growing up in high-risk communities would come to weekly marimba bands. And these groups were facilitated by community musicians and music therapists. And this specific concert brought together young people from two culturally distinct communities, so Xhosa children from the Nyanga township and so-called colored children from the Haderveld community. And the process in preparing for the concert involved the sharing and co and recreating and renegotiating of a range of songs, from distinctly cultural songs to pop songs that the group rearranged for the marimbas. The young people decided to call this concert Bringing the Music Home, and they decided that instead of playing at a community hall, they set up their marimbas on a Saturday morning outside the social housing apartments in Heidefeld. This clip highlights how music is able to express shared communality as we move and sing and play together. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Fauchier. Now we will hear from Dr. Laura Beer.
Ohayo gozaimasu. Buenos dias. Zhao sheng hao. Kuri imure. Hiva huomenda. Good morn. Shub prabat. Good morning. Apakabar. Bonjour. Su un achim. Forgive me if I left your language out. I'm a white, middle-class gay woman. As such, I'm a person with privilege and some power, yet I'm also someone who's been the target of hate and violent acts. I come to this talk about cultural aspects of music and music therapy with this history and with the spirit of compassion. In the United States, we have many diverse cultures. Scholars often refer to the U.S. as a melting pot, where the cultures overlap and blend, creating a uniquely American experience. Recent research, however, is suggesting that we are more of a salad, in which different groups intentionally keep their own identities and tend to band themselves together. One person in a recent study was a native Hawaiian, a state that has a very strong heritage. And when he went to school on the mainland in the US, he said, "At first I was like, yeah, the mainland is like a melting pot. Then I saw you all aren't in a damn melting pot. You're like a salad bar. You all have your own designated areas." So in the field of music therapy, the topic of how to use music from a different culture is pressing and being actively discussed in the United States. Part of the struggle lies in knowing how and when to play different music. The beauty and depth of the many cultural and musical heritages in our world is profound. It humbles my heart and it fills my mind with wonder. How can I hope to fully and properly honor the music I may borrow from another culture, knowing my representation of it may be as clumsy as my attempts to say hello to you? As a profession, we share the world, yet we have so many boundaries, differences, and identities. Even in popular music, genres are blurred and musicians borrow from each other in exciting and creative ways. Who does music belong to? How fluid are the boundaries of cultural identity when we borrow from each other? There are many artists who hear music and genres from other cultures and make it their own, thereby expanding the world's definition of music. This adds to the richness of music. I'm going to play you a brief excerpt of a piece as an example of blending cultures in music. This is a song written by David Bowie and played by Luna, a Korean instrumentalist. So she's playing everything. The fusion of styles is breathtaking, isn't it, to hear her play? So when considering playing music from another culture, I ask myself, how can I be sensitive? Our role as music therapists means we're constantly deciding whether to use familiar music with clients, perhaps to reinforce singing patterns, or strengthen the therapeutic relationship, or to evoke memories. We also have the choice of whether to offer something new or, in a cultural sense, surprising. According to the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, cultural competency means I must maintain a set of attitudes, perspectives, behaviors, and policies that promote positive and effective interactions with diverse cultures. Music therapy literature indicates that client-preferred music is best to use. But now we're finding out that tapping into culturally unfamiliar music may have strong benefits too. So it leaves us with a question. When we use music outside our cultural identity, are we being culturally appropriate, or are we creating a case of cultural appropriation? As I just mentioned, it's already known that listening to familiar music can have benefits. During stroke recovery, listening to known music can help people regain functions of speech and movement more quickly. A study published in 2016 explored this phenomenon more, with the researchers seeking a better understanding of what types of music created the highest levels of brain connectivity and optimization. Volunteers listened to 7 different types of auditory examples during a functional MRI scanning session. The areas of the brain that were engaged the most were from self-selected emotional music, not a surprise, but also the area culturally unfamiliar music activated larger portions of the brain. So it appears there's a clinical significance for playing music that's unfamiliar to a client. It holds the potential to stimulate the brain in healing and productive ways. So how do we decide when and in what manner to introduce culturally unfamiliar music? As therapists, we're constantly weighing options for treatment, for self-disclosure, for what intervention to use, for what music to use next. We can add the cultural piece into this as well. Many presentations at this conference have had a focus on cultural sensitivity. There is a strong sense of respectful curiosity in this conference that I appreciate, and it's inspiring. Offering culturally competent therapy requires critical reflection, a critical analysis of one's own assumptions is foundational to culturally responsive teaching, learning, and practice. Critical reflection on tightly held assumptions is necessary to dislodge misconceptions and stereotypes. So I am not Native American, so when I play the Native American flute in a hospice setting, am I appropriating this instrument, this music? That's a question I ask myself. I also ask, what's the goal? What's the therapeutic intention? As a teacher and clinician, I wonder, how does my cultural and musical background influence how I teach and practice? I also have to be comfortable knowing I'm going to be wrong sometimes, and I need to ask for help sometimes. Am I aware of my biases, limitations, stereotypes, and how I instinctively respond to different types of music? How do my personal values and comfort levels affect my therapeutic presence? Even more important to ask, who is my client? What is their worldview? What is his background, his expectations or needs? So continually challenging myself to answer difficult questions is not just a part of cultural humility or approaching treatment with respect for cultures, but it's a way of life. It's not something separated into the therapy world for me, for I view this type of work as being integral to being human. Identity and culture in music therapy are multi-layered phenomena. We have what we can see at the tip, what shows above the water, skin color, age, race. And then we have below what we can't see, all of these identities, education, geography, hobbies, spirituality, military experience, religion, values, learning styles, and even work experiences. Musical identities are part of this too. A client's history with music, experiences in listening, learning, practicing, performing, these all come into play. Does someone prefer music specific to her cultural heritage? Or was she steeped in Western tradition music and prefers that? We cannot make assumptions about our clients. For example, even in the Western neonatal intensive care unit setting, I went in assuming that many parents would want to hear music from current pop culture. And what I found out was surprising. They requested the music that their parents liked. They had grown up listening to it and found comfort in it. So I find myself singing the songs of John Denver, Aretha Franklin, Elton John, Nina Simone, and the Beatles. I also assumed parents of different cultures would want to hear lullabies in their native language. Several times, however, parents of Hispanic identity told me they wanted to hear lullabies in English because that's what they wanted their babies to hear. So if I had not been listening or actively seeking their preferences, I would have kept playing what I thought they wanted to hear. I also improvise in modal scales, And very often, these improvisations are what the parents relax to most. It's not familiar, and it helps them let go of their thoughts and release some of their stress. So when you start thinking in your own practice with cultural awareness, here are some prompts to consider. Don't fall too deeply into self-doubt, for this can paralyze you and make you unable to grow and keep learning. You will make mistakes. I'm so aware of when I make a mistake, and I have to tell myself, don't get too bogged down and feeling bad, but find a nugget of truth and hold on to it. There might be times also you feel frustrated by the constant challenge you will give yourself to keep your ears, eyes, and heart open. And this is okay. Feeling frustrated means you're working on it. I think we've all felt that way at the piano sometime or the other. I can also offer some suggestions based on my observations, research, and experiences. So if you choose an instrument or idiom that's from a different culture than your own, explain. For me, it's often the Native American flute. I choose this instrument for its soothing tone, its bittersweet melodies, and the feeling it can give of being grounded. Describe. Briefly describe any cultural or historical significance. I talk about how this flute was made for me by a Native American flute maker in Boulder, Colorado. I also talk about how the flute has great importance in Native American culture and plays a role in many rituals. Active listening. Listening deeply to your client's responses. Let yourself be responsive to their response. And sometimes telling a story really brings the cultural piece home. For example, there's stories about the Native American flute used in different tribes for courtship, for love. And encourage discussion. Wherever possible, with your clients, in a group, with parents. So again, listen deeply. It seems to be a theme. To yourself, your clients, for opportunities to bring in diverse music with care and attention, and connect. Connect to your own feelings and your own responses, and connect to those of your client. I'm going to play a brief excerpt of a piece that I improvised and recorded as part of a research project. And you'll hear, I wanted you to be able to hear the Native American flute. So let's keep working on this. Our world is a beautiful one of color, of vibrant music that has emotional power and cultural richness. It's inspiring for me to be here with all of you. I'm grateful to attend this conference, grateful to the conference organizers who've worked so hard, and thankful to have had the chance to learn more about your music therapy. In the gesture of thanks and gratitude in any language,
thank you, Dr. Beer. Please join me in welcoming our final spotlight speaker for this session, Dr. Brunolf Stiga.
Hello, everybody. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. And I want to thank the audience and the organizers and the co-presenters for making this conversation possible. I argue that culture is a significant concept in music therapy, but also possibly a problematic concept. When we, with the best intentions, try to describe our own culture, or think about how to encounter people from cultures other than our own, we do risk starting to treat culture as an entity, as a given frame, as a context shaping people. So by talking about cultural differences, we might risk forgetting about how individuals and groups are similar and different. And I think all of my three co-presenters have been touching upon this issue. So I choose, therefore, not to focus so much upon what culture does to us, but what we can do with whatever tools are available. So you could call this, I'm talking about culture as a social practice. So let's think about culture for a moment, because sometimes we forget about it. It's like the air that we breathe. It's in our body. It's part of every move we make. But it's there all the time. So we might forget about it, and perhaps not remember before something changes, before the temperature changes or something. Other times, culture is much more tangible. Like most people, I have been in places where I have had a hard time figuring out what's going on. But this could be in an island in the South Pacific. It could be in a club in my own city. I grew up just a few miles north of where my wife grew up, but I must admit that sometimes I have much more problem understanding her than most Japanese music therapists I met so far. So you get my point. I rather liked Sunel's figure, you know, when the circles come together, start to overlap, and where there is a clear conception of a shared humanity. In disciplines where culture is a central concept, such as anthropology and sociology, debates about how to understand culture have flourished. One of the pioneers of anthropology in the 19th century, the English scholar Edward B. Tylor, argued that the human mind is universally similar. He combined this idea with the colonial idea that cultures progress from inferior stages to civilizations. And I guess you can guess which cultures he believed defined the standards of civilization. In the early 20th century, many scholars reacted to this and instead stressed the historical particularity of each culture. Such theories helped us understand how culture is related to learning in context. But how people relate to each other across cultures and subcultures and different contexts became obscure. So in the 20th century, many theories about culture ignored the role of the individual, adding to the idea that we are determined by our own culture. In the book Culture-Centered Music Therapy, I argued that it might be helpful in music therapy to think of culture as the practices and the tools that make possible and restricts human connection and interaction. Practices and tools. This argument is informed by the practice theory of scholars such as Bourdieu, Giddens, Vygotsky, and Wittgenstein. It might allow us to avoid the trap of deterministic thinking and to explore relationships between individuals and contexts as transactional or as mutually constituting. And I will come back to this. I will elaborate on that perspective and explore implications for our understanding of music and health. Often, when we start to think about culture, we think about cultural differences, but I also argue that it's very important to think about cultural similarities across contexts, which sometimes are similarities which really require our attention. Consider, for instance, how globalized capitalism has changed healthcare ideas and systems in ways that challenge equity and social justice in many countries. My own context is the Grieg Academy at the University of Bergen in Western Norway, and music therapy services in my country are developed within what is often called the Nordic model of society, trying to combine social democracy and capitalism. There's a strong security net, comprehensive welfare state designed to protect the rights of each individual and each citizen. And this system of strong government involvement is combined with a relatively free market. It's a model that many Nordic scholars and politicians find worth fighting for. Given the developments of globalized capitalism, it is a model under pressure. The Nordic model is a hybrid, and culturally, there is an interesting and complex mixture of individualism and collectivism in a rather horizontal manner in all of the Scandinavian countries. And when we talk about culture, we easily turn to such generalized descriptions. Norwegians are this or that, Americans are this and that, and so on. This might be helpful in some ways. It could give us conceptual tools for reflections, but there are risks involved of reproducing stereotypes. One problem, as mentioned initially, is that we often end up thinking about culture as given entities that shape us. But if people and contexts constitute each other mutually, we need to start thinking about how people and contexts change together. I took this photo that you're seeing now in one little context, just outside my house, last winter. When I come back to this place in a few days, it will be completely different. It'll be intensely green. There will be leaves on all of the trees. And neither me nor my neighbors did any of that. Sometimes contexts change without our own contribution. But some changes are a result of our own activities. You can see that this landscape is kind of semi-cultivated. Living there, I benefit from the work of previous generations of people who used to live there, who have been cutting down some trees and cultivated the landscape. And their work enable and regulate what I can do, where I can move. And as I walk around, I can bring with me an axe or a pick and perhaps change the landscape a little bit more, which again would redefine my own possibilities and limitations for actions. Such transactional processes are even more dynamic when it comes to relationships between individuals and social contexts. As Rika, in her presentation, demonstrated very beautifully, if we think of culture as practice, it's not just about what we do, but how we do things, when, where, and with whom. So the point I want to concentrate on is health as a universal human right, and to see this in relation to localized cultural practices. Since the beginnings of the World Health Organization in 1946, this organization clearly has argued that health is much more than absence of disease. And the Alma-Ata conference in 1978 strongly affirmed that health is a fundamental human right. The World Health Organization maintains that attainment of the highest possible levels of health is a worldwide social goal whose realization requires action from many other social and economic sectors in addition to the health sector. Actually, the health sector probably plays a minor role in this compared to all of the other activities in a society. If we look at the realities around the world, there's a long way to go. There are huge inequities in health in most countries. And there are disagreements about how to promote health fairly and fairly well. The healthcare system cannot solve all of our problems. So in some way or another, we need to limit the responsibilities of the system. This logic easily leads us to reflections on whether there is a core to human health. An absence of disease is probably the candidate most people would come up with if they were to describe a core. The problem with this idea, however, is that it reinforces the medical model as the dominant model in the healthcare system. And this is highly problematic, not least in the area of mental health. Recently, United Nations experts on human rights have expressed serious concerns about the failures of a system that relies too heavily on the biomedical model of mental health services, including the frontline and excessive use of psychotropic medicines. These human rights experts argue that status quo is simply unacceptable, and it calling on governments to move away from such practices and enable a long overdue shift to rights-based and participatory approaches. This might suggest that we need a pluralistic, multidimensional view of health. I have previously argued that it's often relevant to consider three different dimensions of health: health as absence of disease, as personal well-being, and as social participation. To the degree these concepts make sense, they should be understood as sensitizing concepts, concepts suggesting directions where we might be interested in looking. Because how people think about these things needs to be explored in specific situations, individually and at group level. We need research which can look into such questions. In an article in Voices, Hiroko Kimura and Yumi Nishimoto present findings from a study of community music therapy practices in Japan and Norway. Conditions of community differ by culture, these authors argue. And after a critical examination of the literature on individualist and collectivist cultures, the authors describe similarities and differences in how members of a Norwegian choir and a Japanese choir thought about and described choir participation. So we are back to the issue of differences and similarities at the level of individual and group. To what degree are we similar? To what degree are we different? To what degree do we see resources? To what degree do we see problems? It's not always so clear who is who and what is what, or what actions to take. One implication, I argue, is that we need renewed debates about the benefits and limitations of the medical model and the social model of music therapy practice. The first, the medical model, focusing on conditions of the individual, is probably more compatible with the idea of culture as a given entity. The second, the social model, focusing on relationships between individuals and communities, is more compatible with the idea of culture as evolving practice. Such debates could prepare us for more active participation in the political debates about healthcare and justice in contemporary societies. And if we develop our understanding of the relevance of the social model to music therapy, we need to develop our skills in taking part in music therapy as a situated cultural practice. I argue that music therapy is situated in that it's positioned in a context, and it should be clear by now that I think we should not only examine what contexts do to music therapy, but how contexts are maintained and changed in practice, and how they interact ecologically with other contexts. Music therapy is cultural in that it's based in traditions and technologies that enable and regulate human interaction and coexistence. Music therapy is a practice and a social one as such, in that we perform music therapy in the middle, so to say, in between social structures at the macro, meso, and exo levels, and individual agency at the micro level. Via these reflections on the concepts of culture and health, I arrive to the comments I want to make on music in music therapy. Ken Agin and numerous other authors have argued and problematized the idea that music and music therapy is a means to an end. He has introduced the notion of music as medium, as an alternative. The arguments I have made here suggest that music as activity, or perhaps even better, as social practice, deserves our attention. I have previously suggested the notion of health musicking to depict this. Now, in the English language, health musicking, unfortunately, is written as two separate words. In my own language, where compounds are more common, you could construct this as one word. And in this case, that's better. Only when meaningful music is possible are health-related uses of music possible. Health and music constitute each other mutually. I will sum up by reflecting on some current practice developments in Norway. The human rights issues that I described earlier have influenced mental health services in Norway substantially the past few years. A strong, sustained collaborative effort by several user organizations have convinced the parliament and the government about the need to take action to strengthen human rights in mental health services. Since 2016, the right of mental health patients and service users, including patients with psychotic disorders, to choose medication-free treatment has been strengthened substantially. The consequence of this is that many service users now start to have the possibility of choosing music therapy as one of the alternatives to medication. This, of course, does not happen without debate. Many psychiatrists have argued that the political decisions neglect the scientific evidence that suggests that medicines work. The user organizations respond that that is partly beside the point, because the debate is about the right, the human right, to make decisions in your own life. So if we revisit the three dimensions of health, the psychiatrists are focusing on health as absence of disease, in this case, as reduction of symptoms, while the user organizations prioritize well-being at a personal level and social participation. Many service users want to make music. They want music therapy services available at a very different level compared to what currently is typical. We are witnessing a cultural conflict, not between somebody from Norway and somebody from another continent, but between neighbors, between professionals and service users. As in other cases, when we are dealing with conflicting values, it might be relevant to think about how values are articulated in relation to various levels of analysis. The psychiatrists argue on the basis of data gathered at group level. User organizations talk about the right to make choices in your own life. Values need to be checked and balanced in relation to each other. In this case, the value of professional expertise, research and advice versus the value of the human right to freedom. Such conflicts cannot be solved here or on paper. They need to be negotiated locally, over time, and across contexts. This is starting to happen to the degree shared decision-making becomes standard practice in Norwegian mental health service. In shared decision-making, service users should usually have the final word. But they should also receive qualified advice on the benefits of various types of therapy, including possibilities for health musicking in music therapy. These are a few texts where I've tried to write about the kind of things that I have been talking about. I discussed the concept of culture and health musicking in culture-centered music therapy. I discussed possibilities for participatory rights-based, human rights-based practice in invitation to community music therapy, and in an article about the practice turn in music therapy, I have discussed the premise that I've outlined in the beginning of this presentation, namely that it's problematic to think of culture as a given entity that determines our existence, and more helpful to think of culture as an evolving practice. Through musicking, music therapists and service users can create noise, connections, and reflections that can contribute to something new in healthcare systems and societies around the world. Domo arigato.
I'd like to thank all of our spotlight speakers and all of you for being here. We do have time now for questions, so we're going to be opening that up to the floor. If you have a question, would ask that you raise your hand. We will get a microphone to you, and we have an opportunity for some dialogue.
これから質疑応答に入りますので、質問などある方は、どうぞ。そちらの前列の真ん中の方が質問があるようです。手を挙げ続けてください。前列の方からいきましょうか。
Thank you. Good morning. And I want to ask a question. You mentioned about cultural identity, but I was thinking, what about this client doesn't have a confirmed cultural identity, but they are confused with their cultural identity, such as expatriate children who are still formulating their cultural identity, but have to relocate it to other country once in 4 or 5 years. So they're still building it, but they don't have a confirmed cultural identity. So what should music therapy collaborate with them, or how should we help them culturally?
日本の方ならば日本語でも言ってもらえますか？
あ、ごめんね、日本語ダメだと思う。
あ、
すみません、中国人だから。
まだ文化的な背景というのを持ち合わせていないクライアントと仕事をするときにどういうふうにすればいいかという質問でした。
Okay. I can give one response. Thank you for the question. I do have a PhD student who's working on a project exploring these kind of questions, and the challenge of children in such a situation is hybridity, to kind of develop two cultural identities and make them work together. And one of the things the children tell the researcher is that it's very, very important for them in music therapy to have the possibility to make music together with other children. So while she started off with individual music therapy sessions, which often were very helpful and a necessary part of the process, very often as the process proceeded and the children were invited to influence, you know, how to develop services, they very often requested, you know, groups and collaboration and possibilities to participate with other children and to explore their participation in with other children. Also children then more integrated in the Norwegian, established Norwegian culture.
まだその、文化的なアイデンティティを持ち合わせていないクライアントの場合は、まあ、セラピスト自身も含めて、共に参加して、音楽を作りながら、そういう文化的な、アイデンティティの形成に関わっていくということだと思います、その子どもを、まあ、グループのシチュエーションに、招いて、共に参加しながら、共に共同しながらそのプロセスの中で文化的なアイデンティティが形成されていくということだと思います。
Yes, thank you. I agree with Dr. Stieg. Very often, people who are not strong in a cultural identity, especially children, have come from some kind of traumatic experience. And so, being very sensitive to that and being very focused onwho they are in that moment, but at the same time, through music, creating a sense of community, of social connection that's positive, that gives the child the opportunity to interact and to have emotion without any kind of cultural overlay on it.
例えばその他の国から移住してきたような あとは子供だったりとかあとはトラウマのような体験をした子供の場合だとまずそういった彼らの背景について敏感になるということが大切です。しかしながらそういったものに意識を向けながらも共に音楽を通してコネクションですね、そのつながりだったりとかコミュニケーションというのを形成していく過程の中で、共にその彼その本人自身の文化的背景というのが作り上げられていくんだと思います。
That's a really good question, and I think it speaks to what our spotlight speakers have identified, that this is also complex. It's not simple, so thank you for that question.
この過程というのはそう簡単なものではなくて複雑なものですので、そういった視点を取り上げてくださったことに感謝を申し上げます。
If you have a question, be sure to raise your hand so we can see you and get your microphone.
This question is for Ms. Fouché. You talked about the step into the circle experience and how they had drums into that. Could you say anything about how the music manifested when the clients would ask those kinds of questions?
フシエさんのに対する質問ですけども、ドラムサークルですね、ドラムに出て、一緒に叩くという体験のものですけども、音楽がどのように、影響しているのかという話を聞かせてください。
So usually there would be one drum or maybe two different drums in the middle, and each of the children will have a beater.And often the quality of the feeling around their response, you could hear that in the way that they're beating. So if it's a question that they're feeling very strongly about, like they like soccer, it might be very loud or long. and it were, if it was a question, they might be a little bit hesitant towards them, you know, it might. So that was interesting that you could hear the questions reflected.In their playing, but also what has often happened with this activity is that children would, we've also taken this activity and it kind of had a purpose in the beginning and then became a whole different musical activity where they were, you know, they would be, all the children will have drums and instruments and there'll be rap happening alongside the rhythmic accompanying it and kind of step into the circle and play on the drum, if. And different children will offer different inserts. So, yeah, it's a useful activity, I feel, but it then kind of goes wherever the music needs to go.
その真ん中に1つか2つのドラムを置いてですね、でそして子どもたちというか参加者が、まあバチを持って参加するような形態です、そして、まあ、その演奏に関して言えば、常にそこで起こっている雰囲気だったりとか感情っていうのが、まあ、演奏に現れてくるような形です、最初にの時点でどのような方法でやるのかっていうようなことを説明しますので、自発的な、まあ、発声だったりとか、音楽的な貢献というのが自然に発生してくるような形態の活動になっています。
Other questions that are out there? Just raise your hand if you
have. Good morning. Thank you for the wonderful roundtable opportunity. I just personally have one client and I just wanted to ask your opinion. The client, particular client, has mutism and he migrated from US to Australia when he was 13 years old. He's now 29. And at the beginning, he was really withdrawn and he lost his word and also he lost all his senses, pain or ticklish or anything. And refused to contact with any other people and always just withdrawn. And but only he could do is playing the drum. And that's why we just started from individual session. And after 1 year, the successfully gradually he opened up. And a couple of years later, he was able to join in a group. And then nowadays, he is able to perform in front of people or he is not afraid of interacting with anyone. But he still has speech problem. It's been so long years. I think he opened up his mind really openly, amazingly, and it's been really amazing case. But I actually focused on his withdrawal side rather than cultural side. And so I tried to give him opportunity more like a group or more wider social situations. But so his mom guessed, we never know what is exact cause of his mutism because he doesn't talk, still doesn't talk, and intellectual disability as well, so he can't write when he doesn't have any expressive way to convey his thought. And so my question is, his mom guessed the cause might be the migration, the cultural difference or atmosphere changes. And but my focus was always create more social opportunities rather than a cultural problem, like a cultural context. So now I just started to wonder, I never lived in US, so I don't know US cultural context very well. But if you think if I offer more like a cultural side of his problem, through music therapy. Is it clear?
この方は13歳の時に
日本語で言ってもいいですか？
はい、お願いします。
ごめんなさい。今オーストラリアに住んでるんですけど、私の一人のクライアントが今29歳なんですが、13歳の時にオーストラリアに移住してきて、で原因ははっきりは分からないんですけども、だんだん言葉を失って、で囁くような声なし、最後は全く声が出なくなった。セレクティブミューティズムっていうふうに言われたりしたんですけど、セレクティブではなくて全くどの弦全く声がどこでも出ないという状態になって、 全く引きこもりの本当にひどい痛みも感じないし痒さも感じないし寒さも感じないしぐらいの自分の中に引きこもってしまう。でそういう人を音楽だけはしてくれるっていうことが学校で分かったので音楽療法にリファーされてきたんですけど、インディビデオセッションを数年やった後にだんだん彼が変化してグループセッションにも参加できるようになって、もう最近ではコンサートでパフォームしたり誰とでも関われるようになったんですけど、まだ言葉はあんまり出ないんですね。で何が問題なのかなっていうふうに、心が開かれたってことが大きな前進だと思うんですけど、で私はいろんな場に出て大きなソーシャルなシチュエーションの中で書かれるということに着眼していて、あまりカルチャーということを考えたことがなかったので、アメリカからオーストラリアにマイグレートしたことがおそらく原因でそういう症状になったということは、もっとそのアメリカのカルチャーであったりとかファミリアであったそのカルチャーラルコンテクストをもっとミュージックセラピーの中に取り入れなきゃいけないのかどうかということを質問しました。
Thank you. You've given us a case study.
Sorry.
And as such, I feel I don't quite have enough information to give a perhaps an in-depth answer to your question. It's a fascinating question, but just some of my thoughts are that 13 years old in American culture is a very, very sensitive time. Mm-hmm. It's the shift when children move from being dependent on their parents and their identity to being dependent and connecting with their peers and their friends. So that can be a very sensitive time from an identity cultural perspective for a child to move. There's a loss of choice.
Yep.
There's a loss of identity. There are also, there's so much more to know, but the subculture that perhaps this child was involved with. Mm. Was he involved in a goth culture? Was he involved in a skateboarding culture? Yeah. Was he involved in a hip-hop culture, a subculture of American society? And so that is something without knowing, it's hard to know how to address that. So I think that, again, goes back to Dr. Stieg's point of the musicking as being a foundational point, a centering point.
Mm. Yeah, probably I have to search more what he was, like which kind of specific culture he was in.
Sorry, we need the translation first.
Okay. ケーススタディというようなことで、与えられたと思っています。とても難しい話だと思いますので、正解というかそういうものを伝えるのではなくて、私が考えたことをお伝えしたいと思います。13歳の時期に、アメリカからオーストラリアに移住されたということですけども、13歳というのはアメリカではとっても、多感な時期だと言われています。親に依存していると、時から、自立して、仲間と友達との関係を築いていくという時期に、移住することで、その自分の選択の自由だったりとか、自立だったりとか、自己というようなものが、奪われてしまったということがあるんだと思います。ただそこの、どのようなサブカルチャーですね、ヒップホップだったりとかスケートボードだったりとかそういったものを何に興味があったのかとかそういったことに着目するよりもむしろ今彼が抱えている状況の中で音楽ミュージキングを通して、作り上げていくという方に重きを置いた方がいいのではないかということです。
There's one up there.
See a hand way up in the back. Climb the summit.
Hello. I work in a multicultural society, and I get an echo up here, which is a bit scary. I wonder if I work in a multicultural team of psychologists, shrinks, etc. And I wonder if some of your presentations, if some of you have experience with that and could reflect a little on that. Am I clear?
Are you asking about working with teams that are interprofessional and multicultural?
I work as a music therapist, and all my patients come from other cultures, but all my colleagues as well.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
とてもその文化的に多様な、場所で、私は音楽療法士として働いているんですけども、クライアントは、まあそれを反映して、いろんな文化的な背景を持ってきていますし、また私自身がその治療チームの私自身が入っているその治療チームというのもまた多様な文化性を持っている状況です。そういった環境で働くことについて何かご意見がありますかということです。
I can only really speak from my own perspective, but within our organization, we also have a diverse team, a multicultural team. And I have found that really crucial in doing this work to have colleagues that I can, where we can have conversations about how things might be understood within one context or one specific community or within one cultural group, whether it has to do with music or relationships or people or whatever. So having those colleagues has been really, I would say, crucial to making sense when stepping into a context that might be very unfamiliar.
私自身の経験から話をしますけども、私自身もたくさんの多様なバックグラウンド、民族性を持つ人と一緒に働いています。まあ、重要なことは、その中で文化的なこと、音楽的なこと、関係性について対話をするということです。
私はそういうマルチカルチャルなところで働いたことはないんですけども、その自分がマイノリティとして違う文化の中で長い間過ごしたり勉強したり仕事をしたという経験からすると、そういうふうなシチュエーションはなんかちょっと憧れるっていうか理想的なような気もするんですね。なぜならば私の場合一番苦しかったのは自分がマイノリティであと全部同じっていう、そこが一番そのカルチャーに苦しかったところなので、いろんな方がいてクライアントもいろいろだったらきっと見えてくるものがあって、じゃあ何が人間のコアのところなのか、何がカルチャーの違いなのかっていうのがこう話し合えてすごくいいなと思います。
Dr. Ikuno was a minority in the United States, and she knows how to be a minority in the group. So she thinks that it is ideal situation that you have the people from multiple backgrounds and to discuss.So that you would have multiple perspectives. So that's the ideal setting.
I would just add in my own clinical practice and working with colleagues from diverse backgrounds as well as clients, I think what comes back to me is that willingness to engage in dialogue and to listen deeply and to ask whether it's a client, what their preference is, so that even we as a team know what that is, that we're not making any assumptions, but we ask and engage in that dialogue and that we do listen deeply.
重要なことは、そういった環境の中で、意識を持って、相手を深く聞き、そして分からないことがあれば、尋ねて、そして、対話を深めていくというプロセスだと思います。
We have another question up here in the back.
There's one over there. She's got a microphone first.
Am I first? Who's first? Okay, thank you. Sorry. Thank you all.I was very interested in Laura's discussion of using the Native American flute in her practice and ideas about cultural appropriation, which resonate a lot for me. My recent research was into using Indonesian gamelan music in the UK in music therapy practice. And one of the findings was that the relationship between the therapist and the music they're using is very important, how much they really know the music or whether it's their own. And I just wondered if you could comment on that and what your thoughts are around that.
So that was a comment.
A question.
Oh, question.
A comment and a question, whether that's also what Laura has found or would think.
ローラ・ビラ先生のお話に共鳴するところがありまして、私自身もイギリスにおいてインドネシアのガムラン音楽を使った音楽療法をやっておりますが、重要なのはその対象になっているその楽器を使うクライアントと私自身音楽療法士との関係性ということです。
Thank you. That is a very important point.There is a level of appropriation going on in the United States of different instruments, and I think the Native American flute is one of those, which is why I bring it today. There's this idea that we can just teach students now how to use that in a classroom. And we really devalue, I think, the power of the instrument and the connection to culture when we do that.So, yes, knowing deeper information about the history, the value, the purpose of an instrument is very, I think that's integral to using it in practice.
その楽器を適切に扱うということが大切です。私もアメリカの先住民の笛を吹いていますけども、それをどのように扱っていい扱っちゃダメというようなレベルではなくて、その楽器が持っている背景だったりとか、その楽器の持っている歴史価値というのにを知っておくということが重要です。
Thank you.
Yes, I think that's good. Thank you.
One last question.
Hello. I just had a quick question about competencies, speaking now about teaching students. And I'm wondering if there is a possibility to establish clear guidelines to train music therapists in intercultural competencies. And if such thing is possible, being then culture is so complex as we just now saw,what are your thoughts on it? What are the possibilities? Where is the place that we can start?
Well, that's a big question for 3 minutes.
I know.
文化的なコンピテンシーですね。文化について、きちんと熟知しているということ。コンピテンシーと言いますけども、文化的コンピテンシーとでも言いますけども、それをまあそれがまあ学生への指導に対してだったりとか、専門家の教育に対して重要だと思いますけども、それを教える上でのガイドラインというものを作ることが重要なのかどうかということですけども、まあこれへの返答はなかなか数分でできるものではないですねというコメントがありました。
I can just make one minute. Well, attending many conferences internationally, well, maybe mostly in America for me, for probably 10 years ago or 15 years ago, when you put the theme like this, multicultural something, something, the presentation will be like just talking about gamelan, just talking about how Japanese drums are, something like that. And I felt very awkward because it's just like a museum. But today I felt very optimistic about this theme because we are now talking about the way to understand, a way to dialogue, way to not mix, but way to collaborate.And yeah, understand, the way to understand. This is the most essential thing for students to learn about multiculture, I think.
以前私がこのような国際大会に参加をしてその多文化的な音楽療法という話を聞くとですね、大概ガムランの使い方とかハープの使い方とかそんなのは博物館に行って私は博物館に来たのかしらなんていうような気持ちになりました。重要なことはどのようにその相手の文化を理解するのか、そしてどのように彼らと相手と話をするのか、異文化の人と話をするのか、そしてどのようにその異文化の人とコラボレート、協働するのか、その方法を探していくことが重要だと思います。
I think that is a great and important question, and a question that we really need to carry forward. Because there's so much there, and given we are at 10:30, so I feel like we're not going to be able to answer your question sufficiently. But I do think it is a question that we all need to carry with us and really continue to look at, and as a profession globally to continue to hold and sit with and explore and find some answers to. Thank you for being here, and I hope you would please help me in thanking our spotlight panelists today for their time and expertise.